Follow the sound of the bell inward.
Good morning, God. Thank you for the beautiful morning and for the great weather we're having right now.
Yes.
Thank you for each and every person present and those people in our family who are not now present. I joyfully send out love to each and every one and to everyone else. Thank you for lovingly supporting all of those who are affected by fire this summer. And thank you for being here and right now. Opening my heart, opening my mind, opening my soul, I prepare to listen. As I hear about the middle way, a more moderate way, and I follow it in everything except my relationship with Spirit, knowing that each person gets exactly that little bit that they need, and knowing that I do, and knowing that all is well. I speak my words into law, knowing that they're already so, and I say, thank you, Father, Mother, God, and so it is. Amen.
Thank you, Lucinda. That's beautiful. Good morning.
Good morning.
If you're new with us here this morning, my name is Sri Daughter, and I am a credentialed prayer practitioner here at Mystic Heart Spiritual Center. And we are an interfaith, independent community that teaches universal principles and practical spirituality. We open our doors in welcome, trusting that you will be led to guidance and wisdom of your own heart. And we begin our teze with musical prayer.
Lay aside whatever came before.
Settling into this one perfect moment, we take a moment to breathe, to allow the breath to bring us fully present, following it in and feeling the life flowing into every cell, every atom, and following it out, letting go of any tension. With every breath in, feeling the body come to life. And with every breath out, letting everything go. In this sacred moment, there is only the breath. There is only life unfolding. There is only now. As we settle into the present moment, we give thanks for our deep connection with all of life and for our awareness that we are connected to all that is. This is what is meant by global community. Not only our human family that is spread across the earth, but also the more than human creatures, the plant beings and rock beings, the sand that covers the beaches, and the waves that rise and fall on the shores. All that is seen and all which is not. That which is known and that which will never be known. All connected at the deepest level. All teeming with the life of God, shining with the light of Spirit. Take a moment to sense the light shining in and radiating from everything that exists. Notice how there is no border between us. One light melding into the next. We are one light expressing as infinite diversity. As we take the time to feel and know our oneness, we grow in compassion, empathy, and understanding. We come to understand that every thought, word, and action matters. And we take care. We become more mindful with each passing day. This month, our contemplations are centered in Living Buddha, Living Christ. And this morning, we reflect on the middle path. The middle way is a Buddhist teaching that may be interpreted by the average person as the path between the two extremes of asceticism and indulgence. A midpoint on a continuum between a complete lack of material attachment and a overindulgence and sometimes obscene acquisition of material objects. And this is how it is most often described. But Reverend Helen Cummings, a Buddhist monk at the Redding Zen Buddhist Priory, teaches that the middle way is more like a koan, a puzzle that cannot be solved intellectually. She compares it to the middle verse of a Rumi poem called A Great Wagon. Out beyond ideas of wrongdoing and rightdoing, there is a field. I'll meet you there. When the soul lies down in that grass, the world is too full to talk about. Ideas, language, even the phrase each other doesn't make any sense. The breeze at dawn has secrets to tell. Don't go back to sleep. You must ask for what you really want. Don't go back to sleep. People are going back and forth across the door sill where the two worlds touch. The door is round and open. Don't go back to sleep. The idea of black or white, right or wrong, good or bad, are human concepts, but beyond black or white is a space we don't see, where there is no conflict, there is no right or wrong. We tend to look at every situation in our life as good or bad. Our dualistic way of thinking puts everything and everyone in a box with a neat little label. This way of separating people and things may make us feel like we have it all figured out and that we are safe, but this mental division is at the root cause of our inner and outer conflicts. In Rumi's field, there are no labels or judgments. We experience absolute connectedness to and oneness with everything and everyone. As he writes, even the phrase each other doesn't make any sense. The middle way is a place beyond the opposites, beyond the continuum.
If your eyes are not already closed, please close them if you're comfortable doing so. The middle path, the center point between two extremes. For Buddha, the middle path was between extreme asceticism on one hand and sensual indulgence on the other hand. Moderation. Finding a balanced approach in various dimensions of life, including desires, emotions, relationships, personal choice. It encompasses both external actions and internal mindsets. Sometimes the center can seem veiled, hard to see. We can feel strongly pulled in one way or another. That is when we go to prayer and meditation. Think of an issue or situation that has been troubling you. In your mind, ask, what is my middle path through this situation? Remember that when you ask a question, sometimes the answer comes a little bit later in the words of a friend, in something that you see. So, stay open. Thank you, God, for the loving support that I always receive from you. Thank you for the guidance in helping me to choose the best way through any situation so that everything turns out in the highest and best interests of everyone involved. Thank you for the gentle guidance and support regarding my health, my relationships, my well-being. Thank you for helping me to keep my feet in moderation on my own path. Thank you for supporting me in staying in the moment so that I can spend ever greater amounts of time experiencing the joy and wonder of oneness. Speaking my words into law and knowing that they're already coming true, I say thank you. With deep gratitude, thank you, Father, Mother, God, and so it is.
Spiritual teacher Osho brings together the teachings of Buddha and Christ, teaching a direct and experiential approach to spirituality. He says the only way to understand Christ is to become a Christ. Never be a Christian, be a Christ. Never be a Buddhist, be a Buddha. He teaches personal transformation and transcending of traditional religious labels, creating a direct, personal experience and understanding of spiritual truths. In this moment of silence, allow the wisdom within you to bring forth religious or spiritual labels that you are attached to. What would it be like, feel like, to release the grasp on those spiritual labels, to allow the graceful flow of change to move through this area of your life? Let's have a moment of silence. Join me in prayer. There is ever and always one life, forever giving of itself as all of creation. I am a perfect and intentional expression of that one life. Like Source, I am eternal, understanding and unchanging in my divine nature. And in my human form, I am impermanent, forever changing, as is the world around me. In this holy moment, I look past all appearances to what I know to be true. I know for myself, as I know for each of you who reaches for prayer, that the nature of life is goodness, wholeness. All life forms have the inherent capacity for healing. Setting aside my human perceptions, I sense the presence of God at work. I call forth the power, intelligence, and grace of God and allow it to move freely through the lives of each one of us, right here, right now. Bodies are healed. Minds and hearts are peaceful. Relationships are graceful and loving. Wholeness prevails. Every being finds right livelihood and is supported abundantly. Thriving prevails. Each one knows balance between activity and rest, and is blessed with activities that nurture the soul and feed the spirit. Harmony prevails. I bring myself back again and again, mindfully attending to what is before me. I trust the process, letting go of attachment to outcomes, in deep faith that all are guided and guarded by the divine hand. I trust in divine order, divine timing, and divine wisdom. I release any and all doubt, knowing that by whatever apparent outcome, all is unfolding perfectly for the good of all. Everything that unfolds from this moment forward is answered prayer. I take a moment now to feel the power and presence. Deeply grateful, I release. I let it be. So be it. Amen.
Heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing hallelujah. 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 Your faith was strong, but you needed proof. Saw her bathing on the roof, her beauty and the moonlight overthrew you. She tied you to a kitchen chair, she broke your throne, she cut your hair. From your lips she drew the hallelujah. 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 Maybe I've been here before. I know this room and I've walked this floor. I used to live alone before I knew you. I've seen your flag on the marble arch. Love is not a victory march. It's a cold and it's a broken hallelujah. 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 I did my best, it wasn't much. I couldn't feel, so I tried to touch. I've told the truth, I didn't come to fool you. And even though it all went wrong, I stand before the Lord of Song with nothing on my tongue but hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Come back into the awareness of your body. Notice the atmosphere in the room. And when you feel ready, gently opening your eyes and allowing your gaze to take in whatever is before you. Feel free to look around and say good morning to everyone who is here celebrating with you this morning. This is your spiritual family, one of your support systems. These are some of the people who care about you and are there for you. As we close our Teze meditation, we offer the opportunity for you to share your financial good in support of the work we do in the world. If you're joining us online, you can find a donate button on our mailing address at mysticheart.org. We thank you in advance for your gifts. We acknowledge and give thanks for the infinite abundance of spirit. We are living in the overflow. In this moment, I'm so grateful for your gifts. Of your time, your talent, your treasure. You're just a blessing to this community. So know that right here and now, that I love you. I know that as we give, we receive. So I know that these treasures do wonderful work in our own community of Mystic Heart and then travel out into our city, state, country, the world. So I simply release knowing all is good. And so it is. Amen. And then feel free to grab a cup of something warm or cold next door and meet us back at 10:30 for a conscious conversation, and we'll bless you on your way with a soul's blessing song.
May your soul always find what it's looking for. May your heart always lead the way. May you live in peace and harmony. And may love always fill your day. May your path be strewn with happiness. May success find you every way. May you always embrace compassion and grace, and may God always answer your prayers. May you always embrace compassion and grace, and may God always answer your prayers.
Thank you for being here. The beautiful song.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, baby. I saw you fancy.
Please join me in prayer and let my words speak for you.
Hi, Kimberly.
Good morning again, God.
Good morning.
Thank you for the beautiful weather and the coolness of the day. It's always a treat when it's so hot out and then we get a cool day like this. Mm-hmm. Thank you for everything we learned at the first service. Sheree is such a wonderful speaker.
Amen. Amen.
And thank you for all of the knowledge that each one of us holds and we will share together for this service. And so at this time, I open my heart, I open my mind, I open my soul as Sheree continues leading us in a discussion of the middle way. Knowing that all is well and that with everything that's going on right now, you've got this, God. I say thank you with deep, deep gratitude. Thank you, Father, Mother, God, and so it is.
So it is.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lucinda.
Thank you.
It was beautiful as usual.
Thank you.
Good morning and welcome, or welcome back.
Good morning.
Yeah. Morning. Those joining online too, welcome. If you're new with us this morning, my name is Sheree Dotter, and I am a credentialed professional prayer practitioner here at Mystic Heart. We are an independent interfaith community, and we teach universal principles and practical spirituality. We open our doors and welcome, trusting that you'll be led by your own guidance and wisdom of your own Mystic Heart.
Sing your heart, make this affirmation. Spirit and a family, loving hearts to share. Together we are growing, practicing the apostles of the new earth.
And everything possible.
So we will learn and fear the Christian heart.
Let us be reminded who we've come to be.
One great family.
Join me in our weekly ritual. Ritual, especially a prayer and visioning ritual, is so powerful. We don't see the immediate impact we are having, but we know absolutely that we're making a difference in the imaginal, setting a new cause in motion. So let's take a creative journey, calling upon the full power of both mind and heart. Engaging the body, and joining with one another in the imaginal realm in service to the creation of a love-soaked world. See and feel with me now a world in which all inhabitants of this planet live from our highest potential, kindness, generosity, and compassion. Peace. Cooperation, In this world, all people honor and care for one another, for all of the life forms that share this beautiful planet with us, and for Mother Earth herself. We remember that we are connected to all of life, that we are dependent on the planet to sustain us and on one another. By aligning our every thought, word, and action with our vision, we are creating a world in which all people are well-fed, have the safety and comfort of home, and a deep sense of purpose and belonging. A world in which health, education, and healthy relationships are supported by social systems grounded in integrity, compassion, and wholeness.
Yes. Amen.
Valuing every being for its uniqueness, we practice living truly authentic lives where vulnerability is celebrated.
Yes.
There is no need to defend or protect. The work we are doing within ourselves shows up as a world free of hatred and violence. We recognize the abundance that surrounds us. Greed is a thing of the past, and generosity flows freely in every direction. And all beings gratefully receive all that is needed to live physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually fulfilling lives. The planet and its beings thrive like never before as we learn to recognize the sacred in everyone and everything. And we walk in reverence and gratitude for all that we have been given. We maintain this vision day by day, moment by moment even. We align our actions with our vision, living these changes first in our own lives, with our families, friends, and neighbors. And one neighborhood, one community at a time, a new world is being born. In this process of profound change, this beloved community stands as an open and welcoming place for all who seek support, belonging, family. By the power of our deep faith and inspired action, this prayer is acted upon, answered even as it is spoken, for Spirit knows our heart's desire and intent. In full expectation of its graceful unfolding, we release our prayer to the creative power and intelligence that I call God, to the one that gets it done.
Amen.
And so it is.
So it is.
Amen. Bringing awareness back to our body, to the room, this beautiful life, and to the amazing beings who share this space with us this morning, look around to say good morning to your spiritual family.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our theme this month is Living Buddha, Living Christ, and the topic of conversation today is the middle path. Buddha and Christ taught parallel ideas of suffering and salvation. Buddha brought profound insight as to the nature of suffering, while Christ brought the path to salvation and an overarching concept of divine love. Both of these great teachers provided a framework for understanding the human condition and offering solutions for transcending it. Buddha presents the Four Noble Truths. In Sutra of the Four Noble Truths, Buddha says, you should know sufferings. Life consists of suffering. If we want to liberate ourselves from future suffering and future lives, or just right now, we should not waste this precious human life. this precious moment, even. You should abandon origins, the origin of suffering being desire and attachment. You should attain cessations. Refrain from or cease from that which causes confusion and suffering. You should practice the path. This is the path of higher moral discipline, ethical living, and higher wisdom. This leads to permanent liberation from the sufferings of this life and future lives. These instructions are known as the Four Noble Truths, and they are noble truths because they are superior and non-deceptive instructions. Jesus Christ teaches salvation and divine love. He teaches that salvation is a gift from God. Salvation can simply mean preserved or delivered from harm or ruin or loss. Being freed from our mistaken beliefs about ourselves or about the world. There is an unconditional love of God for humanity. Through his parables such as the prodigal son and sermons such as the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus teaches the concepts of mercy, forgiveness, and a personal transformational relationship with God and eternal life. Both Buddha and Jesus taught ways to end human suffering. That's what it comes down to. That's what we want to know. Buddha through the cessation of desire, and Jesus through the transformative relationship with God. Both liberating the individual from the bounds of pain and suffering. During this morning's teze, we reflected on the middle way, a Buddhist teaching that the average person may be familiar with. I personally assumed that it was the path between two extremes of asceticism and indulgence, a midpoint on a continuum between a lack of material attachment and the overindulgence and obscene acquisition of material objects. And this is exactly how most resources describe it. But for me, the contemplation of our topic, Living Buddha, Living Christ, suggested someone actually living the spiritual principles. So, what better way to do that than to go hang out with the Buddhists? So, Gary Solberg, I'm going to call him my resident Buddhist. He introduced me to Reverend Helen, a Buddhist monk at the Reading Zen Buddhist Priory. Reverend Helen, she was very generous with her time and patient with me. And she teaches the middle way is more like a koan, which the meaning of a koan is being a puzzle that cannot be solved intellectually. She said that it is more like the Rumi poem, A Great Wagon. And I will read the first part of the middle verse to you now. Out beyond ideas of wrongdoing and rightdoing, there is a field. I'll meet you there. When the soul lies down in that grass, the world is too full to talk about. Ideas, language, even the phrase each other doesn't make any sense. So how do you interpret what he is saying? What is resonating with you?
Anyone?
Go ahead.
Well,
you had your hand up.
I was nearing what you're supposed to do.
Oh,
yeah. I'm being an example. Here you go. Chris?
I think it's talking about being free of any kind of attachment or judgment, and it's a place where you're resting in the realm of infinite possibilities.
Mm-hmm. I love that. Thank you.
That's one of my favorite sayings,
yeah.
You know, the first part about the field.
Yeah.
Because I love that because there is no right or wrong. Mm-hmm. It's just our perception. And if we can let the right or the wrong, or who's the right and who's the wrong, or who did this or who did that, and you can go into that field with an open mind and a loving heart, mm-hmm. then anything can be accomplished.
Mm-hmm. That's so true. I love that. Thank you for that.
That's my favorite verse.
Kristen? I think this notion of time and right and wrong and this side, that side are human constructs for us to navigate the world.
Mm-hmm.
But in that space, in that field, those dissolve. They don't have a place in that realm.
Mm-hmm. I love that.
I think we're actually, when we do the Love Soap Rule meditation, we're talking about living that kind of a life,
mm-hmm.
where people can be exactly who they are, and without judgment, they can be exactly what they are, they can believe what they want to believe. And there's no judgment, there's no right or wrong. You don't believe what I do, so, you know, if you don't, then somehow that makes me little or something. There's none of that stuff there.
Yeah.
So I think in a sense, for that kind of a world, we would be living in this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then, is there anything else that wants to be spoken right here?
It seems to me the field is beyond the physical realm.
Mm-hmm.
And so we can access that field anywhere. That's the gift of going within to that field. It's beyond our world here.
Right.
And it's a peace. It's a knowing. It's a loving. Mm-hmm. And we all have access to it.
Yeah.
Because yeah. Otherwise, I wanted to know where that field was.
Yeah. And you're pointing to it. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
You know, the Buddha, I mean, he certainly didn't suggest that we shouldn't have enjoyments and appreciate life and not be passionate about the things that we care about. So when he talked about, you know, not pursuing desires, he wasn't saying you shouldn't have things that you like this more than that,
yeah.
But if you don't get your way, accept it. You know, it's the attachments to having the things we want that create suffering on top of suffering.
Mm-hmm.
It's wanting things to be different, or wanting things not to be different.
Mm-hmm.
Wanting to hold on to what you have, and then suffering when things change, because things always change. You know, things that we don't like in the moment, you know, they will change, just like things that we're really, really digging in the moment, they'll change too. And he also taught that this saying, I can't even remember the comparison, but they talk about, you know, the huge length of time the universe has existed.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, beyond anything that we can comprehend. And within that space, we've taken birth. And it's such a rare gift to be born as a human being. And don't squander it. I mean, there's so many things we can do in this lifetime that we couldn't do before we were born, and we can't do after we give up this life on earth. So really, really, every moment, every day, appreciate it, and you know, do what you can to share that joy, that appreciation. And anyway,
I love that, the preciousness which is coming through as I look at you, and it's making me tear up.
of every moment and this life. And a book that you gave me to, Buddhism from Within, you know, and you're totally pointing to it, and I'm probably just going to be saying the same thing, but that sometimes when we hear the suffering part, we think, oh, okay, if I'm a Buddhist, I have to suffer. And it's just really pointing to the human condition and saying it doesn't have to be that way, that you can pursue desires, but that you don't have to get so attached that then you cause more suffering on yourself. And even distracting you from that constant pursuit of better, best, whatever, that actually, that distraction of, well, I'm just going to pursue more. If I'm distracted by this and the pursuit, I'll just pursue more. And you're piling suffering on top of suffering. And so it's beautiful how what I learned is pointing to the human condition and then teaching you through simple, like the Four Noble Truths, very spelled out, of this is how you can really liberate yourself from that suffering. So really appreciated the time with you.
And then the three pure precepts in our tradition, in the Zen tradition of the Soto monks up at Mount Shasta, you know, they say the first thing is to stop doing the things that cause suffering. Mm-hmm. And they say cease from evil, and evil is something that causes suffering, either for yourself, for another person, for a dog, a cat, an ant, a mosquito, whatever. And then the second is to do only good. I mean, do things that don't cause suffering. Mm-hmm. And then the third is do good for others. You know, the ultimate is not just be in it for yourself, but
yeah. Once you get yourself straightened out,
right.
Pass it on.
Yes. But the first, like the Socrates or whoever talked about the Socratic oath about for doctors, do no harm. You know, that's the first mm-hmm. thing that doctors are supposed to learn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we can all learn that as people, as we go about our lives, as to recognize the things that we've done in the past, the things that we might be tempted to do right now. And if it's going to cause harm or suffering, maybe not do it.
Yeah. Yes. I love that.
Come on, I like touching a burning hot stove.
What, Pete?
I saw over here, I think, a hand.
Babe? Yeah, I read something recently that kind of encapsulates, to the extent it can, all the things that have been said so far. And basically, it says that our true salvation is our connection to the field that you referred to in the stanza of your poem. It refers to what they've recognized as being beyond that which our human body inhabits, right? And so you have to get beyond, I have a little acronym I use, BET, BET, get beyond your body.
Mm-hmm.
Get beyond your environment. And I know there's a third one that I have to remember.
T.
Beyond time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you, in the moment, you have to extract yourself from that which makes you, this may sound contradictory, extract yourself from that which makes you human and access the field that is the possibility of all that is.
I love that. Thank you.
Sure.
I wrote something, but we don't need it anymore.
Well, be like that.
Anything else want to be spoken at this moment?
Mm-hmm.
I've come to realize that there's things that cause me pain and suffering, and even with relationships. And then I realize, you know, I'm not happy with the situation. Mm-hmm. I've done everything I've thought of or tried to do, and it hasn't changed. So I have to accept that I can't change it, then forgive, and then let it go. Mm-hmm. And when I will go through those steps, and it's not real easy, they're really hard, big steps, but when you finally let go of that, that gives you peace, mm-hmm. because you can't change it anyway. So you might as well accept it and let it go.
Yes.
And
what you're saying too, that I'm going to admit this, is I go, oh yeah, spirit. Oh yeah, prayer. You know, because I think my brain is supposed to solve something.
Yeah. Yeah. Let go and let God.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And then I have to listen to the answer.
Yep.
Novel approach. So the next verse of the poem, because I just so much got into it, right? So I'm going to read that next verse. The breeze at dawn has secrets to tell you.
Mm.
Don't go back to sleep.
Mm. I love that. That is the best.
You must ask for what you really want. Don't go back to sleep. People are going back and forth across the door sill where the two worlds touch. The door is round and open. Don't go back to sleep. So what's coming up for you here? How would you interpret this verse, or what's just resonating with you? Say anything you want.
I just turned it off. I was going to take a picture of it.
Can you go back, Michael, and leave it up there?
Okay. Sorry, I just...
And keep it up there for a while, because I'm going to go into it also more.
Okay. I like it.
So just in general, anything that comes up for you here?
Well, I think sometimes when you're doing life, and you're realizing that control is an illusion. When you're doing change, there is that temptation, because change can be really scary. Taking the next step can be really scary. And there's that temptation to just sink back down into what it was, mm-hmm. and pretend. You can't go back to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
You can't, but you can pretend. So I think there's that temptation to pretend to go back to sleep.
Yeah. Chris?
I think the phrase don't go back to sleep is to not get stuck in your habitual patterns of mm-hmm. response and approach and language and mm-hmm. thought. Find, stay awake, stay mindful of what it is you're thinking, what it is you're saying, how it is you're doing it, and are you fully immersed or is your energy fragmented?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Bob, were you scratching or?
It's an idea coming.
So I feel like it's like you wake up and something beautiful happens in your life, and you're so grateful for that, you know, and it's lovely. And then you want to return to that, but you have to realize, I have to realize that there's so many individuals on this earth,
mm-hmm.
and they all want to feel that way. And so I have to remember that my ego wants to get what I want and see everybody kind of falling into place and doing, and then I have to realize, hey, everybody feels that way, you know? And so that's a big challenge because, you know, you get invested in how you see things and want to plan them out. And so does everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
So,
oh no, you can't relate at all.
No. Don't go back to sleep when you realize. You know, I forget that all the time. I'm like, oh, why does this happen? Oh.
Yeah.
You know, and like sitting here today and being among my tribe, I'm like, oh yeah, remember, Moaine.
I realize that I'm awake, and I go back to sleep a lot, and then I'm awake. But when I'm asleep, then I'm in the chaos. Then my life doesn't work. Mm-hmm. And then I'm in my monkey mind that's on that cage that's going 100 miles an hour round and round. And when you're awake, you go, oh, wait a minute, I don't have to be in that wheel anymore. I'm okay. I accept everything. It's okay. I'm not happy about it, but I'm okay. Mm-hmm. And to realize that the divine within me is all there truly is, and that divine is everything.
Yes.
And that's when you're awake, when you realize that. Mm-hmm. But when you're asleep, you think that you're just... whatever.
Right. I love that. Thank you. For this.
Dave.
Oh, Dave. Hey, Dave.
Hey, Sheree. You know, it reminded me of 30 some years ago. I joined the CSL Center, and James Golden offered a new membership. Welcoming thing at his home, and we were sitting and chatting, and you know, I really respected him a lot, and he seemed like what his gift was to bring me awake, and I was always so wonderfully blessed by that. And I asked him, you know, I just joined this center, and I asked him, could you make sure I don't fall asleep again? And he said, I can't do that.
That's up to you.
I thought he was my savior, you know, like, okay, I made it to the shore, man, hold on.
Yeah.
And that we could make someone else responsible for our
awakening. Yes.
Right.
So, yeah.
Hey, hold this rope, would you? Don't let me go. So I all through my life, I've found out that, you know, that's the thing. When you're not asleep, you're here and now. You're in the now. And you see it all. But then you snooze, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think we're just learning how to stay more awake more of the time. And then we don't suffer. We don't fall into those opposites and negativity and stuff. So, yeah, I think this is all the journey of awakening. So.
Yes, thank you for that. Mm-hmm.
Chris Johnson, the younger version.
That's the name of the term.
Yeah, I know. Chris Johnson, the other, is listening, so he's going to get me. And then we'll go Kimberly.
I've got a question, actually. In this analogy, is being awake, like being present, being embodied, being aware of what's going on around you, and being asleep is like habit and routine and being in your head?
Mm-hmm.
You
got it.
Or is it something deeper than that?
I mean, you could go deep, but I think simple is good. So I think you're right on. I think that's perfect. Because that's what it is. It's like, are we awake and remembering that we are the divine in action, and spirit is who and what we are, and it's coming through us? Or are we forgetting and everything is a problem around us,
I was just reading the line, people are going back and forth across the door sill where the two worlds touch.
Yes.
What if being awake means keeping one foot in the divine and the other foot in the temporal world and allowing the divine to guide the body?
Yes. That's so beautiful, Chris. Thank you. I agree. I mean, yes. Because if we can remember, we're not ever just here or there. We're in space in both. And they're not even here and there, right? It's now the field that there isn't any separation. And we remember that divine goodness
is right where we are. It is who we are.
We are spiritual beings having a human experience.
Yes.
Nicely put.
Another word for asleep is, oh my God, I forgot. I was doing really good, and then all of a sudden, I just forgot I was God. And that can be asleep, or you forgot. Oh, I need to remind myself I'm God again. Oh, yeah. And when you do that, then that opens a whole, that opens all the infinite possibilities. So asleep means that you forget. I forget all the time, so.
Yes, thank you. Cheryl?
People going back and forth across the door sill. I describe that as my two kids who are very conservative. And my daughter came to visit for a week. And she didn't bring up politics, but she had a way of sending daggers. Little hints stuff. So I never responded. I was very careful. And I just let it go. And I know that must have irritated the heck out of her because I didn't respond. I was very quiet about it. And then just at the end when they got done with my bedroom, she helped me remodel my bedroom. It was beautiful. And my son came over, helped out a little bit. And then we were talking about bed, pillows, and all that stuff. And they talked about Mr. Pillow.
Oh.
I don't.
Yeah, my you know, pillow. He's going downhill because everybody doesn't like Trump. I said, oh, well, you know, I like my pillow in the other bedroom, and I just try to change the subject. But I just was conscious of that. I'm going, if I respond, I'm not doing me any good.
Right.
You know, he just kept quiet. After I got her to the airport, my son got me home, I went to my husband, and I said, thank God I can relax now. I was just like, oh, man.
But, you know, they can't see online, but the keeping it zipped, and you guys talk about, you know, the keeping it zipped. And I love that as a perfect example of letting go of attachment, the Buddhist principle. Because if we're attached to conservative liberal, if we're attached to pillow, this pillow, or right, wrong, then we get in that funk and, you know, and we forget.
Yes.
The number one is the love between you and your daughter.
That's right.
And so it really sounds like it prevailed because, and you got a new bedroom, and
I love that.
And you just have this really nice, warm, and
exactly.
That's so beautiful. I love that. Kristen?
I sometimes would call that not taking the bait, and I would relate that to lead me not into temptation.
That's good.
Deliver me from that temptation.
There's a Jesus principle.
There you are.
Yeah.
So just seeing the pillow instead of all the feathers, huh?
Oh,
I love
God.
That.
Buddy.
My son years ago would drift off into politics and not saying which side we're on. You know.
That's good.
But, okay, so I said, we need to just agree to disagree.
Mm-hmm.
And since then we have great conversations and, you know, we don't bring up politics anymore.
Yeah, because I mean, some things, it can be all different things, right? It could be religion, it could be anything, right? Uh-huh. It could be the weather sometimes.
Right.
And so it's like whatever the disagreement is coming up in that moment, if we can keep ourselves awake and stand in that doorway, we can realize that my number one thing here is not that, is not being right. It's relating and loving this person that's with me right here in this moment, even if it's a stranger. Because if we give them that loving kindness and compassion, we're going to get that. Right? I broke down too, and we're already doing it, so I'm so excited that you guys are already into it, because I was like, each one of these
first, this line is a spiritual principle. Mm-hmm. So I asked him to keep it up, and we've really already, we did a bang-up job on people are going back and forth across the door sill. So I'm going to read each one, and then if something comes up for you. So what I'm looking for is a spiritual principle or a spiritual truth that you feel. That there's no, like, it's not in a textbook or on the internet. It, you know, there's no right and wrong, okay? So we're in this field of what's it bring up for you as far as a spiritual truth that it may be pointing to, okay? So the first one, the breeze at dawn has secrets to tell you.
Well, to me, that says when I first wake up, I'm not the sender for the day. Mm-hmm. I'm just the person who's just woke up, and so I'm more likely to be listening mm-hmm. to messages that are coming through to me, and they do. Mm-hmm. You know, and then later on in the day, as life goes on, I will confess that I don't always stay in the moment. And so I'm not always hearing, but at dawn, when I first wake up, I'm available. And I'm hearing
that. A reminder for our spiritual practice in the morning. Yeah, mm-hmm. I love that. Sure.
Just being here in the moment. An example, when I go walking, my mind will start working. Mm-hmm. The hummingbird will fly, look at me. I'll talk to the hummingbird. That's the breathe for me. Mm-hmm. It takes me out of what I'm thinking to focus on the now.
Yes.
The moment. Enjoy that moment right now.
I love that.
What I get from that, when I first heard it, it made me smile. To be, be still and know that you're God, but to really be still and just be quiet, and things come to you, ideas come to you, the secrets of the universe will tell you whatever you need to know if you're quiet enough to listen.
Yes. Do we have anyone on this side of the room that I wasn't looking? Okay. So the next one. You must ask for what you really want.
Yeah, be careful. Sometimes we ask for things that we really want, and it's not really
what we want
or what we should be wanting or what we need. And there's a lot of that is driven by your subconscious mm-hmm. self from a psychological standpoint.
Yeah.
We live about 95% of our lives as a robot, robot.
Autonomous.
And so you just have these programmed reactions you have to circumstance, no matter what that circumstance is, mm-hmm. what that is. So, you know, kind of the whole goal is to get to the middle way, which is kind of the theme is, it's not at the extremes, mm-hmm. right? It's divorcing yourself from the extremes, from the world of duality, as Gary might characterize it. Get away from there, mm-hmm. and try to pare away or cut away those things that are making you operate habitually mm-hmm. from your subconscious, and stay focused on that. Easy to say, not very easy to do. It's like, as Chris said, keeping your one foot in the field and one foot in the world,
yeah.
right? What did Jesus say? Be in this world,
but not of the world.
It's the same. It's the same concept.
Yes, that's beautiful. Thank you for that.
That's
awesome. I don't know who was first, but you guys share.
I think for me, I could take that one sentence and try to answer it for the rest of my life. Truly, because I've had things I've wanted. I really wanted them. I got them. Now I'm like, they're a burden because I have them. you know, I got to take care of them.
The other
that
side of
that goes back
the
to make sure it's something you really and truly want and need.
Well, I really and truly wanted and needed it at the time. I felt that way.
Yeah.
You know, house, big house, you got to, you know, property, got to maintain it.
Well,
all this stuff, you know, children. Hey, children. What children? And, you know, it's all like, what do I really want? And I could almost, I could answer that inner peace. Okay, but what does that mean? You know, what does that mean? Oh, a lot of my friends, like, get up, 5 o'clock, let's meet at 6 o'clock, we'll walk, we'll do this. I'm like, hell no, I'm not getting up. No. You know why I don't want to get up? Because I know when I get up, I'm gonna face a world that's not meeting what I think I want. So I'm like, I'm not getting up that early. But now that I see, you know, we're discussing this and it's bringing these ideas to me, like, yeah, I'm gonna get up and I'm gonna say, what do you have for me today, world?
Mm.
And how can I be, you know, serving this? Instead of like, oh, I'm not gonna get up because I know I gotta do this and then I gotta do that and da 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 da, I gotta take care of this. I mean, it's just a different inspiration when we gather and we look at this and discuss it.
Yes, it is. Mm-hmm. It's reminding us.
Yeah.
Right? I think Dave, right? And then Dave over here.
Hey.
So
okay.
Dave's first.
Dave too is first.
Well, I just always kind of flash on. Early on, well, many, many years ago, a rock band taught me that lesson. Mm-hmm. Was you don't always get what you want.
Oh,
but you
yeah.
Get
yeah.
What you
she
need.
Said
it
right.
Yeah.
Get what you need.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
I caught that lesson right then.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I love that.
Yeah, I would expand on that because it's exactly what I would say, maybe in different words. It's like, fortunately, we have this force that lives within us that knows what we really need. So when you ask for what you think you want, you might not like the answer. And that's, I think the intent of that intelligence is to tell you, look elsewhere, because that ain't gonna work, right?
Yeah.
So just, and it's difficult sometimes to recognize the answer.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because if it's not what you think you want and you've asked for it and you get something else, the recognition of how that might play into your desires or your, you know, the wish that you made or what you want.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, you know, it's pretty difficult sometimes to understand the language in which that force speaks to you.
Mm-hmm. That's so well put. Thank you.
When you said that, expanding on that, the soul knows the way home,
mm-hmm.
and thank God it has GPS. So it brings us to these things, but it knows how to get us where we need to go. And that is a way in which we can learn to be at peace and relax, that it is all going to be okay.
That's so true. Gary?
You know, when you if you ask for what you really want, it's not like a child writing a request to Santa Claus and waiting for it to show up. If you know what you really want and you don't go back to sleep, then you know what you have to do to let the world unfold so that you have what you want.
Mm-hmm.
But you have a responsibility to facilitate, to make it come true.
Yes, so true. Am I seeing you, Dave?
Well,
where were you itching?
No, I had a thought coming
you're
through.
So,
and I was just adjusting.
You're so flowy.
Yeah. Well, I was wondering if, since we're all striving for a love-soaked world, yeah, would it be better if we all got super soakers?
Yeah. This today is part of our super soaker.
There you go. It's just squirting out.
That's awesome. I love that. What brought up for me, I think, also when you were speaking, Dave, is, well, every part, right? It kind of started coming up and even like bubbling up from way back is during our practitioner studies, they use a fancy word of spiritual equivalence. And it points to what you're all saying as far as, you know, we might say, oh, I want a new car, right? Mm-hmm. But what is it that I really want is maybe freedom. Mm-hmm. And so if we find a spiritual truth or a divine quality in what we're asking for and then pray for that, then... Mm-hmm. Right? The sky's the limit. The field's there where freedom is on its way, no matter, you know, what we think we may want in that moment. Mm-hmm. And I love that because I've also done where, oh, I want this particular, and I get this particular, and I go, this is hard. I don't, why did I even ask for this, you know? Mm-hmm. So I love what you're all saying about that because I think we can all relate to that human condition. Anything else want to be said for that line there?
What I believe is that our soul or our spirit knows what it wants to experience, mm-hmm. and so we have our heart's desire come up. And then you, especially if you've been wanting it since you were a child.
Yeah.
And so it's okay to want things and not have a whole lot of patience because it hasn't shown up yet. But that's the lack part, is that it hasn't shown up yet. But yeah. But I think that we do have desires that... Mm-hmm. I have a desire, you know what it is, and it's there, and I've tried to get rid of it, and it still keeps coming back. So yeah. It's more than just what this Kimberly wants. It's what my soul wants to experience, and right. I honor my spirit and my soul for that. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to say, sometimes you have wants, and you go, wait a minute, I'm done, I'm fine, and it keeps coming back.
Yeah, and that could be the sign.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think maybe what it's also saying, ask what you really want. Seek the kingdom within, what it is you want to be, and then all things are added to you.
Yes, that's beautiful. Thank you. I love that. Okay. I think we did a wonderful job on the next, so I'm going to go to the door is round and open.
I think the round door is the field, and it's a path through the door, and it is always open.
Yeah.
It's me or whatever that shuts it or thinks it's shut, but it isn't. It's
right.
Always open.
Yes. Yeah.
The quantum physics field. Mm-hmm.
Anyone else?
I think the notion of round implies unity and inclusiveness.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always available, unity and inclusiveness. Don't go to sleep, stay awake for being able to be inclusive.
I see the door as the path. There is no right or left. It's straight ahead and it's open.
Mm-hmm.
The roundness is like there's no hard edges.
Yes.
You know, it's swift.
Welcoming, right? Because
mm-hmm.
it's that is just
yes.
warm and fuzzy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Also during Teisei, we spoke about a spiritual teacher, Osho, who brings together the teachings of Buddhism and Christianity, Buddha and Christ. He teaches a direct and experiential approach to spirituality, and he says the only way to understand Christ is to become a Christ. Never be a Christian. Be a Christ. Never be a Buddhist. Be a Buddha. What do you think of this quote? What do you think he's saying, or what's resonating with you? Do you agree?
Christians, I'm doing my very best to get rid of that, but it's a real trigger for me, especially when I've had Christians go, "Oh, trust me, I'm a Christian." But anyway, I'm really trying to let that go. And to be Christ-like, it's an energy, number one, a vibration, number two, and as for all Christ-like, the world would be a different place, or the Buddha too, because they both were the same coin, or they were the same side, or they were the same thing. They all were the path back to yourself, which is God.
Christ
or Buddha, they never put, the idea is never to put yourself first or above anything, to realize like all humanity is one, and to proceed in your life like that. Like, you never read a story like, "Oh, Christ decided to whatever, take a vacation for 2 days, he went to Cabo," you know, that kind of thing. You know, I've never read anything like that. Like, he was looking, he, Buddha, whatever, were looking out for themselves. There was no looking out for themselves. It was looking out for everyone. Because everyone is themselves. They're all, they understood that concept of being all one.
Yes. Yes. And they both had that direct experience of spiritual awakening. That that direct transformation.
Don't fall asleep. Is that what they were saying?
Yeah. Anyone else on that?
There's no hate.
Yes.
No hate.
Yeah. Yeah.
And guilt is man-made. I don't think God made guilt.
I think that reminds me of, say, be the Christ. Well, what is the characteristics? So you can be beauty, you can be love, you can be harmony, you can be cooperation. And that beingness translates into the doing.
Yes. I love that. When you think of the qualities of Buddha and Christ, it's their very essence of their being. And our mission is to put that in the world, right? And put that in action, because we are spirit in action. So as we practice these principles and go out into the world, we share that love, compassion, forgiveness, mercy. Yeah, it's beautiful. Is there anything else that wants to be spoken before we pray?
So do you think developing a Buddha belly?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Well,
been working on it.
Yes, it's fun to rub, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but when we think of any spiritual teacher that we've, you know, known about, read about in either in the past or current day, and we look at that as an example of how to live our lives.
Mother Teresa.
Yes. Yeah.
Diana Johnson.
Oh, yes. Yes.
She walks That's through really talk, and she's the most amazing woman I've ever met. And I am
we
so
love you, Reverend
we're
Diana.
So honored. I'm so honored to have her as the leader of this particular place we are right now, and to be my friend.
Yeah.
So.
She lives it.
Yes, she does.
Yes, she does.
Yes. You're gonna make me cry now.
Nice, Kim.
This is a good time to go and,
I was just going to say, all of that which we're alluding to is they are in service to the world as the world needs it.
Mm-hmm.
They were responding to the needs that were in the world from mm-hmm. their spiritual nature as opposed from their judgmental nature.
Yes.
Exactly.
And it's not an easy calling.
No.
And they do it beautifully. We love you.
Mm.
Yes. So let's go ahead and close this out with a prayer. Let's move into the heart space, deeper
and deeper inward. Allow yourself to return to the truth about you, to your divine center, your true nature, at the heart of all that is, one source, one life, one, forever loving, forever giving of their infinite nature, becoming all of creation, experiencing life as me, as you, as all that has ever existed, and all that will ever be. I am. You are. Created in the image and likeness of Source, pure, unblemished, whole, and complete. Take a moment to feel and know your own divinity. The physical world is fleeting. And we are privileged and grateful to be a part of it. It is ours to make this experience as beautiful and joyous as possible for ourselves and all who cross our paths. We accept this call today. We give thanks for this beautiful day and all of the blessings that are constantly showered upon us and around us. We give thanks for the opportunity to gather with our chosen family in celebration and communion with God. We give thanks for this amazing life with all that it brings, those things that are graceful, easy, and beautiful, and those circumstances that grow us in patience, resilience, character, and love. From this place of gratitude and in faith that my prayer is answered even before it's spoken, I release it now to the loving and lawful presence that I call God. It is done, and it is so. And together we say, and so it is. Amen. Take a moment to allow yourself the awareness to return to your body and to the space and beautiful gathering. Welcome back. I invite you to join in the celebration of work we are doing in the world by sharing of your financial good, should you choose to. If you are at home, you can go to mysticheart.org to use our donate button or to find our mailing address. We also have a gracious giving program for those who would like to make a heartfelt monthly commitment of support, so that we can more effectively budget and plan for our growth. Please enjoy this song.
This song is a stream of consciousness song. And which means essentially that you never listen to the lyrics. You just listen to the feelings that they convey. And that's why, to me, it has magic. But you can't listen to it. You just have to feel it. Mm-hmm. only holy eyes. Dream of only me. Where I am, what I am, what I believe in. Hallelujah. Holy dream. Wanting only you. And she comes, and I run just like the wind will. Holy, holy. Sing a song.
Sing
a song of song.
Sing
it out. Sing it strong.
Sing.
Ah, yeah.
Camera angles in there.
Yeah.
Like that. I love that song. I always love that song, but it just really came to life right there.
So taking this moment to be in deep gratitude for the gifts that everyone brings to this center.
Yeah.
both gifts of time, talent, energy, and the love. Thank you for allowing us to go forward and spread service to all. With deep gratitude, I say thank you, Father, Mother, God, and so it is.
And so it is.
Amen.
Amen.
And please join us in our closing song. Love be with you.
Oh, yeah.